92.1 WROI, WROIFM.com. We are streaming audio live on RTC Channel 5. Soon to be audio and video on RTC Channel 4. That's why Elizabeth joins us this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
And Doc Talk Radio on the air with Dr. Eric Seward, OBGYN at Woodlawn Hospital. We have a very interesting topic that he's going to introduce to us momentarily, but I want to remind our listeners, if you have a question for Doc Talk Radio, give us a call, 223-6059. We'll be happy to pass it along. Morning, Dr. Seward. Thanks for coming in.
Good morning.
You made it through kind of a blustery day. But
it's, you know, I think it dovetails well into what we're going to talk about here.
It does very well.
One of the genius things, I think, about the whole holiday season is that it somehow distracts us from the crappiest time of the year. And you know, today's a great example of that.
But the song says it's the most wonderful time of the year.
And, you know, you can convince yourself of that
that's
sometimes.
Right.
I think that's... Yeah, I always think of the holidays in sort of the four F terms. We have the fun, the family and friends.
That's right.
And food.
Yes.
Today we're going to talk a little bit about food and eating well and dieting and staying healthy during the holiday season, which is hard. It's a big challenge. I think American culture is sort of built around the binge. We tend to... When we go in. I think if you compare us to, say, France and drinking,
right.
The French have a glass of wine at every meal. The Americans have seven beers on football Sunday.
And, that's right.
You know, and that's right.
That's
and
exactly
so
right.
That it just sort of illustrates that. And I think if you look at our seasonal habits, we tend to get into whatever groove we get into. And ultimately, we throw it right out the window about Thanksgiving time. And from that point forward for the next month, I think everybody just sort of puts the rule book down and forgets what they're doing with regards to diet and exercise, because we feel like we've got New Year's coming up and we can make some resolutions and fix it.
Absolutely.
That.
Sure.
Right.
Sure.
Well, I would like to get out of that mindset a little
bit. All
right.
Let's try
it. Now, I am all about New Year's resolutions, and maybe this is a topic for New Year's, but when you think about what resolutions are, basically, you're basically saying this is the starting point of whatever it is. And that starting point can come at any time. We like to use big round numbers. A lot of times if you're, say, training for a marathon, you're going to say, I need 20 weeks to train for a marathon.
Exactly.
You mark whatever the marathon is on the calendar. You count back 20 weeks and say, this is when I start, you know, elevating my training. And you could pick anything. A prize fighter fighting a big fight is going to do the same thing. It may be 16 weeks, it may be 14
exactly.
weeks. Exactly. You know, and you go through certain process of doing that. I think you know you can look at that process from a beginning point or an end point. In the case of New Year's resolutions, I'm all about them. I think they're great. I don't think that we should fatten ourselves up to lose it all at New Year's, though. and that's part of the problem that I find myself in sometimes. And I mentioned this earlier. I the choir could preach to me a little, because I am. Currently in a gravy and turkey coma.
I understand.
And for the first time this week. And I think, what is your favorite Thanksgiving food?
Well, of course, turkey, gravy, mashed potatoes, the whole nine yards.
I, for the first time ever, made my mom's sweet potato casserole recipe.
Very good.
Which is like, I don't know, it's like calories in heaven, all like woven together.
Exactly.
In bite-sized bits. But I never eat them in bite-sized bits. I eat them by the plate.
Hey, is there any left over?
And I think Christmas is kind of the same way, and kind of the build-up to that. I imagine, I haven't been to the office yet, but I imagine you walk in there, and this is when it starts, when the onslaught of tins of caramel popcorn and cookies and coffee cakes and
exactly
and everything that's sweet and delicious and it's hard to pass those things by. The other thing, and I think this is where things get a little bit tricky too, is that when the weather outside is crummy and you look outside
frightful.
The window. Frightful. You're outside the window today, and maybe you're thinking about going for a jog or going out and taking the dog for a couple mile walk. You might think twice, and it's hard. The light. I was just noticing this. Well, the last few weeks, really, you get up and it's dark.
It is dark,
and it's starting to get dark.
Right.
You know, 5:30, 6 o'clock. I think last night when I was thinking about, I was out chopping down a Christmas tree.
Okay.
And, if anybody in the city park, that tree was not the one I chopped down. I went to a bona fide lot.
Didn't do that one.
But, you're out chopping down a Christmas tree and you know, in the dim light, and it was 4:30, you know, and I'm thinking, oh, my goodness.
Exactly.
This time of year, it gets tougher and tougher and tougher to have motivation to do some of those counteractions to, you know, if we're going to increase our diet, we need to increase our activity. That said, though, I think one of the first places that I would point out we can make a big bonus in how we approach health in the holiday season is to not forget to be active. And this is the time that maybe you, if you don't have a gym membership, maybe you go get one. If you have a gym membership, this is a time to use it. You know, it's a time to, you know, consciously get in there a few times a week and use it to try to remember that despite the fact that it's dark and it's crummy weather, there are ways, and it's a good way to ramp up to, say, New Year's. I think a lot of times we go on diets, we decide we're going to get our beach body, we have all these high aspirations. Anybody doubts that, go to the gym today, go to the gym like the second week of January and see the difference. There's a lot of people that are going to get hyper-motivated to do these things, and it's almost better to take it in installments. And one might look at, say, the month of December as your ramp up to exercise for the beginning of the year.
Good thought.
And so that's a one way that you can look at it. Another way that another thing I would like to point out is, you know, I just did a turkey trot on Thanksgiving down in Broad Ripple. And there was one in Fort Wayne. There's probably a dozen others around.
Right.
I know that some of my family were running over in Logansport. There are lots of these holiday, and they're usually low-key, not hyper-intense, running, walking events that are out there where you can go out and do a Santa hustle or a snowflake dash.
And I like what you say about the running and walking, too, you know, either way.
Oh, there's a
right.
You have to be able to walk whatever the distance
is.
Most of these are going to be relatively short 5K kinds of events. But they're, I mean, really, we joke about this, but if you ever look at the name of a race and it says hustle, it says like Santa hustle or shuffle or you know, anything that has to do with a turkey or holiday. All of these things tend to be really low-key events in the sense that they're open to everybody. They're encouraging everybody to come out. If they say something about killer or death or, you
Iron
know,
Man.
Or ridiculous, you know, mountains or anything like that's in the title, watch out. But with that notion in mind, I would just encourage everybody to stay active, because being active is really half the battle. If you're going to up your input, you need to up your output.
Okay,
it's
makes
a
sense.
pretty simple idea. Second, and it gets back to this conscious idea. There's a whole theory to the approach to food of conscious eating, and the idea behind that is, if you look at a piece of food, an apple or a pie or a whatever, turkey leg, and you look at that and say to yourself, is this something I want to incorporate into me? By eating it, that's exactly what you're doing. Now, this is a difficult thing to do constantly for most people. I struggle with it. Once in a while, I will think, boy, do I really want that second piece of cheesecake?
Exactly.
And I think that the argument might be in this time of year, this is a great time of year to say it's okay to sample the fare. It's okay to eat, you know, your favorite recipe at Thanksgiving or Christmas. It's okay to have that cookie at work that your you know, your assistant brought in, or you know, somebody that works in the office brought to you or sent to you. It's okay to try those things. It's also the season to give. And so, you know, share those cookies, spread them around, spread the wealth, have one and pass them on.
Sure.
I think that, you know, looking at these things from that conscious perspective of, you know, how many of these, that's how I look at it. Not so much, do I want this cookie in me, but how many of these cookies do I want in me? And if you really think about it, you can try one and then maybe not eat all of them. I think that's a good approach. There are specific places I think we sometimes run into problems, and one of them has to do with this whole idea of binge eating. We might not eat very much day to day. We might get into our normal routines, but then at the Christmas party on Saturday, you go nuts. Or at Thanksgiving dinner, you eat for the entire month, and then unbutton your pants, watch football, and exactly. Go back and eat some more.
Right.
And I think that maybe if you come into the thing from the beginning with the idea that this is what I'm going to do, not so much I'm just going to snarf down anything and everything that looks good, but I'm going to fill my plate with this, 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 and this. Be aware of what's relatively healthier.
Okay.
Turkey's not unhealthy.
Right.
You know, it's
exactly.
There are, cranberry salad, for the most part, is fairly low calorie. Most of the salads, just depending on the dressing, are fairly low calorie. So a lot of these things aren't necessarily bad foods as long as you're not, eating them by the boatload. And so I think with that in mind, just the conscious approach to coming into, say, your Thanksgiving dinner or your Christmas dinner or your office party, with the idea that I'm not going to overdo it, but I am going to enjoy myself.
Is this the gospel of moderation?
I think that always gets us
okay.
back. You're better off to moderate constantly than to just go nuts. It's fighting our national consciousness because
exactly.
that's what we do. But,
right.
It's what's sort of bred into us, and it's a fun time of year. And I would say, regardless of your perspective, regardless of your religion, regardless of your approach, this time of year is full of bright lights and festivities and excitement and gift giving and all kinds of old recipes that are being made and new recipes that are being tried and all of that stuff is really fun.
Sure.
I'm a bit of a foodie. I like all that stuff. But that's a really exciting part of the holidays. But if you approach it from the beginning, if you go into your event, into your day, into your week, saying, hey, this is how I'm going to approach it, and then you consciously make that effort to think, boy, is this something that I really want to incorporate into my system
exactly.
and my health. I think what it means is that you'll try the ginger snap, but you might not eat them by the...
Six of them?
Yeah, six of them. you'll try a little slice of that cheesecake, but you might not eat the, or you might savor each bite a little bit more and then maybe not feel the need to go on and eat the next cheesecake.
And Sue and I sometimes say, am I really hungry or am I just eating this because it tastes good?
Well, I think, and there's also the emotional part of eating that I think gets stirred up at the holidays both ways. I think that some people get really excited about the holidays and they're fired up for all the things, the eggnog and the things that are familiar from years gone by. I think this is also the time when people that are emotionally eating for other reasons, sadness, whatever, that probably... now you got available food being shoved at you
exactly.
right and left, and it's none of it's healthy, or very little of it. And
right.
so it's
right.
real easy to just say, give me more, give me more, give me more.
Sure.
And kind of derail a little bit. Again, I would just encourage everybody. It's not a bad idea. I'm not a big believer in getting on a scale every day, but I think it's not a bad idea to get on a scale once or twice a week. The Weight Watchers philosophy is weigh in once a week. You don't want to overthink it too much. I think this is the month that if there was one month that I would say, don't fret so much what you eat, but try to stay active and try to consciously eat. I think this is the month that I would do that, because you don't really want to go into that New Year's resolution thinking, I've just gained 30 pounds, now I have to lose 50.
Right.
That's a very unhealthy way of addressing things. It would be better to go into that with other motivations. And that gets me sort of to the final point here, which is I think when it comes to New Year's resolutions, and this is something that we've sort of batted around before, it's nice to make a resolution that has something to do with weight loss. That's okay. But goals tend to not get met if they're not specific and they don't have an end point.
You need to be practical.
Yeah, and the problem is, you know, it's one thing to say I need to lose 10 pounds, so I've got a goal to lose 10 pounds. Or maybe it's 20 or maybe it's 50. But there's a goal, and you need to have a plan to get from here to there, and you need to do it in sort of installments. And I'm a big believer in sort of making short, medium, and long-term plans. So when people are thinking about, say, weight loss for a New Year's resolution, this week, today, I want to do a specific thing. This week, I want to lose 2 or 3 pounds, whatever it might be, or a pound. This month, I want to lose 5 pounds or 8 pounds or whatever you think your reasonable goal might be. And then by May 1st or whatever the date is that you set for yourself, I want to be where my ultimate goal is.
Smaller goals to get to the big goal.
Small goals, all aim to get to the big goal. Right. And I think weight loss is fine, but there's this over-importance put on weight. If you ask any of my patients, you line them all up and say, are you healthy? people tend to do this. They tend to say, well, I think I'm pretty healthy, but I could lose a little weight. This is almost always the thing that they say. And, you know, they'll be smoking a cigarette at the same time and doing five other things that you're like, well, wait a minute. But the truth is that weight has relevance and it's objective, and therefore it's a nice, easy thing for us to think about with regards to health. But really, we put way too much importance on it. There are some relatively healthy, bigger people. There are some very unhealthy, skinny people. Case in point, when somebody gets cancer, they tend to lose weight. So there's not, you know, just to being thin is not necessarily
right,
healthy.
Right.
It's really a balancing act of you know, how do you use that and what does it mean to you? Sort of emotionally. I think a lot of times too, when you're 40, you're looking at yourself as your 18-year-old self, and I think sometimes we have to kind of modify how we think about ourselves at different points in our life.
Exactly.
These are all very, very, you know, critical, important things to kind of consider when it comes to like, well, what should you weigh and what should those goals be? And I think now is the time maybe to start to think about that so that when New Year's does come around, you have a very clear objective. I personally would also argue that it's better to make, instead of making a weight loss goal, or maybe in addition to making a weight loss goal, you make an achievement goal. The achievement goal isn't necessarily weight loss. You know, I oftentimes use the Indy Mini. The Indy Mini is a half marathon down in Indianapolis,
sure.
One of the biggest ones in the country,
right.
If not the biggest. Quite a spectacle, quite an event. If you look at that as sort of an end point and you start in January jogging a little bit and ramp it up a little in February and start hitting some real miles and workouts in March and then sort of taper it down towards the end of April, go out and run that thing, cross the finish line. It doesn't matter what you weigh, you're going to feel pretty good about yourself.
You did it, sure.
And you're going to have to be pretty healthy to go through
right.
That process. It creates health along the way. It also aids in weight loss sometimes. I would caution people that exercise doesn't always make people lose weight. It's an input versus output thing, and I can eat way more than I can exercise. I could do that in a minute. but that said, it is a critical part. And you know, you can sit down with a pen and paper and do the math on food in and output, and you can show how much importance exercise has and how much importance it is to get up and move. If you sit on a couch, you burn, you know, half as many calories as you do if you're inactive. If you're that person that's getting 15 or 20,000 steps on your step counter a day, that's you know, you're going to almost double your energy output, which means you're either burning off twice as much of the calories or you're capable of eating twice as much, depending on your perspective.
Kind of a simple question, but you mentioned weighing yourself once a week, twice a week, daily, however you are inclined to do that. Same time?
Well, it makes more sense. I mean,
yeah.
funny story, had somebody that was in the office right after New Year's, they were on a diet and they got weighed and they weren't apparently weren't happy with that, so they snuck back out in their skivvies and hopped back on the scale and got discovered, you know, more or less naked, standing in the hallway weighing themselves. And yes, all that stuff matters, and we recognize in the doctor's office if somebody walks in and they're 5 pounds more than they might think they are, yes, we understand your clothes weigh stuff, and if you eat breakfast, it changes. We used to do this thing, and when I was running, where we would go weigh ourselves, go run, come back, weigh ourselves again, and then stand it. And there was a contest to see how much you could regain just with one big drink, you know, as much as you could drink in one. And it turns out you can lose 6 or 7 pounds in a hot day running, and you can gain back about 4 of those pounds in one big gulp of water.
Sure.
So weight, again, is kind of finicky. So if you want to get consistent results, you're right. For me, I'd probably do it, you know, first thing in the morning, right out of my shower, you know, just consistent. It's not perfectly consistent. You know, it still matters what you ate yesterday. It still matters, you know, if you're retaining fluid or if it's humid outside, things like that. But it's more consistent that way.
Okay. Dr. Eric Seward, OBGYN at Woodlawn Hospital, talking about the holidays, shall we say. Folks who have questions or would like to see you, get a hold of you, how can they do that?
Hey, I'm over at Woodlawn Hospital in the physician clinic, which is on the east side of the hospital. We're in the phone book. There's ads out there. I'm available most of the time.
Okay. Dr. Seward, as always, thank you. Happy holidays to you and your family. I know that next month we're going to be doing this a week early because of the way the holidays fall. So,
it was either that or be here on Christmas Eve, right?
We didn't think that was too good an idea.
You know.
We'll see you on the 17th.
Okay.
Dr. Seward, thank you.